Dr. Catherine Meeks, Executive Director of the Absalom Jones Center for Racial Healing for the Episcopal Church. One of the most important things that I think needs to be happening in our society right now is that young people and old people need to be in conversation with one another. I think that we've lost something by creating this kind of divide between the elderly and the young. I think that having young people interviewing senior citizens is just a wonderful way to facilitate some of that conversation that I think needs to be happening. In addition to that, I think it's so important to collect these stories from the older generation so that we can have them as time goes along, because some of these folks are in their late 80s and 90s and they're just not going to be around that much longer, and we just really need to capture their wisdom and spirit and hope. So that's kind of the foundation out of which this has grown.
I'm Adeline Taylor, and this is Miss Virginia Clark, and this is our video for the Intergenerational Oral History Project.
When I retired, I had 46 years of civil service. I had three children, and my oldest daughter is 70. She's on her way to Australia. I think she's gonna come to Atlanta when she comes back. And she and I will probably get an apartment together. Like I said, the middle daughter was killed. And I have my son, who I live with now. And my daughter-in-law, we get along quite well. They had seven children, and the youngest is now second year of college. So they're not interested in having any more children because my little grandchildren want to come live with me. So I don't know how that's going to work out. My daughter, at that time, she was my oldest daughter, my middle daughter, was active using drugs. And I belonged to a program called Tough Love. And part of that was to tell her that she could no longer come to my home if she was using drugs. And I told her that night, and this drug dealer felt that she was trying to steal from him. And he chased her and killed her and shot her between the eyes. So then I had her child, which was two at the time, and I raised that child and sent her to Montessori school. And she's now 29 and has two children of her own. Then my son and his wife decided to move to Atlanta. So just recently they decided that I should come to Atlanta. So I came in 2017. Well, the 90th birthday party was arranged by my daughter in Minneapolis, and they rented the hotel space, and they invited all the relatives I had. See, originally I was from Omaha, Nebraska, and so all my relatives from Omaha came, and relatives in the Twin Cities came, and I think there were over 100 people there. It was very nice, and I didn't realize I was loved so much. But when I came to Minnesota, I was the first of my family who came, well, other than my mother, stepfather, and then different cousins. And they'd come to my home and get their start before they branch out someplace else, and which I didn't mind at all because it was nice. I had a big enough house, and they'd only stay a while, and then they'd get a apartment and move on and get their own home. So I think I have about 50 relatives there now. I was active with the Minneapolis Open League. I was active with the NAACP. And I was always active at the church. I didn't participate in anything that I thought was illegal or would cause trouble to me or my family. Okay, well, I guess we had those sittings in Minnesota just like we had all over. So when I worked in City Hall, what we would do, we'd make a lunch appointment, like at the, we call them dollar stores here. There were 5 and 10 cent stores in those days. And we'd go and sit, and they wouldn't serve us. We'd just sit there, and then it was time for us to go back to work. We'd go back to work. So we did that every day, and we recorded to the NAACP.
What does family mean to you?
Everything. I mean, the most important person in my life. I really can't say. Coco the dog. I have a lot of family and all that. So they're all important. Future? Well, since I'm 90 years old, I think it's just to rule gracefully.
Hi, my name is Dory Wilson Foster. I am going to the 12th grade. Today is Ms. Thelma Williams, and this is the Intergenerational Oral Project.
Growing up, did you have any best friends?
Yes, I did. I had a best friend, and we did a lot of things together, and went to the same school, and it was good to have someone. Her name was Enid, and she lived right around the corner from me. And we just talk to each other all the time, you know.
Have you ever experienced racism?
Oh, decidedly. Yes. I think one of the real hurtful things that I remember was when I was in college and I just transferred to that particular college. It was a wonderful college, but racism was at its height. And the thing that was most painful is when I went to this particular class, and it was such a huge class that they did it in one of the auditoriums, and the brown person I saw was me and one of the other students. And this fellow got up, and he turned to the instructor, he was sitting on the side of me, and he said to the instructor, "What is she doing here? What does it mean that you bring somebody like that inside here? This school has no room for people." And the instructor said, "I don't wish to discuss this with you. All the students that are here belong here. But she doesn't belong here, and I don't have to stay here, and I'm paying your salary that you're here." And she said, "Well, I'll let you make the choice. I'm not going anywhere." And it was so fulfilling to hear her speak that way, but it was so hurtful that in a class of 90 people, that he's saying, "You don't belong here." And I'm saying, "Wait a minute." Not that I'm not used to racism at all, but to personally feel it, he wants me to just get up, and I'm such a threat to him. And then finally, I don't know what happened, but the instructor came over and said, you sit here and you'll be comfortable and don't worry about this.
What was a typical day like in your childhood?
In my childhood? We got to remember that there, my mother and father had 11 children, but only 6 of us lived to maturity, because in those days, the poverty and all of those things, 2 of my siblings died at birth. And so, but it was 6 of us. And I was a pain in the neck, because I was just wanting to get into a lot of mischief all the time. And
a typical day.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I had a younger sister, and she was ill. She was born from birth ill. And I had another younger sister, and then I had a brother, you know, that was old. He thought I was a pest. And then an older sister who was really a genius. She taught at university, she did this and that. She really was a genius. And then I had an older brother. So, you know, we were scattered all around, seeing that I was the one that was in everybody's way, in the sense that, you know, I had no this and what's that and why can't. So my mother would kind of say, you know what, you're going to help mom in the kitchen here, and we're going to cook food for everybody. And I loved it. That's the one thing that could, you know, she was always cooking. She never went to cooking school or anything and have those days. But I was right there, you know, learning.
I hope that some of the things shared with the group, I hope that some of the tragedies and things that are happening in our world now, that those of you who are growing up and experiencing and seeing them, have a broad spectrum that you could see how your knowledge and your care and goodness as a person can have such a profound effect in the world that we live today. Okay, I need that.
Who is or was the most important person in your life?
Wesley is really. We've been married for 62 years. This was before, of course, my mom and dad. Okay. But he is just an extraordinary person. Now, that doesn't mean we have some perfect marriage. You know, I get on his nerves, he gets on my nerves. But he thinks of me and his family and treats us in a manner that I've never had that experience before.
Watching you for some time, can't stop staring at those ocean eyes. Burning cities and napalm skies, 15 flares inside those ocean eyes. Your ocean eyes on
what is your life about? knowing what makes one happy. And by that I mean, what is it that you can do that can give pleasure to yourself as you interact with other people? That's what I'm talking about. Interacting.
So you like making people happy?
Well, that's one of our goals, yes. Can't make all situations good or feel good.
I lost a long time ago for you.
So,
did your parents ever tell you about how did you get your name?
My aunt suggested my name. I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was Audrey. And in the middle, and my mother, decided my middle name Curtis. For Archie Curtis.
So, Archie, talk about your childhood.
Not much to say. The usual, this is what happened, it's the mischievous. I was getting in trouble. Thank God I had parents and mother that put up with me.
So you just answered my question. So, what kind of trouble did you get into?
Well, you know, I'm not coming home early enough. They had a rule, if the street lights come on, you gotta be at home by that time. Of course, in the neighborhood, we would stay out late doing something we shouldn't be doing. But I guess I was all right. No.
All right. So do you have, like, any people that were in your community that was, like, leaders to you at all?
Well, back then, this old saying they have now, it takes a village. And back then, I don't want to sound too old, but back then, if you could do something would happen in school, the principal would get on you. And then if something happened in the neighborhood, Miss Peg, next door neighbor, if we did something wrong, she would get us. So everybody in the neighborhood would get you. So you would get beaten, two or three beaten before you got home, and then your mother would get you. So really it was a lot of people who looked out for us. A lot of people.
What did you think you would be growing up?
I really never thought about it. You know, all I know is that I would hang out with my brother. We did a lot of arithmetic, math. Unfortunately, didn't really have career counselors too much back then. So back then, you just get your job and, that's about it, but things are a lot different now, with career counselors and finding out what you're good at and going forward.
All right, for my next question. In life, have you ever felt lonely?
Of course, whenever we don't know what our place is. If you have good family, close family, friends, those times happen less, and when they do happen, they kind of help you out, so you can get a better outlook.
All right. Do you have any regrets?
Of course. Plenty of them.
Did I hear about something?
Well, certain decisions you made. The outcome didn't happen the way that you thought it would happen. But what you realize is you can't go back. So, you look forward, so you take what you have right now and make tomorrow better, because you can't go back to this. So, but nothing that's, so terrible. But this is your future.
What is your future like?
Well, I would love, I think, this is something we all should strive for, is to be independent, to be able to decide what you want to do for yourself, where you want to do it. I think that would be quite so much better. So, just the things I want to do, I love history, I love trivia, I love, from a church standpoint, a ministry of reconciliation, getting people to appreciate each other. So just doing those type of things, just health and strength. Oh, yes. So tell me about Seraphina Foster.
About 1 year on top.
Not as much as you would like to.
Well, I am 14, was in 8th grade. I want to major in science. And I want to, when I grow up, I want to be a veterinarian. And the college I want to go to is Berry College or UGA or the one down here, Georgia Tech.
Now, is that in Macon?
I think so.
Good area.
Yeah, my mom said it's UGA and Berry is a great veterinary school. So.
So once you become a veterinarian, and you're going to be a dentist, I'm quite sure.
Yes.
Okay. So what do you think your practice will be at? What location? What city will you think you're going to be moving to?
I don't think I will be moving. I just want to stay in Georgia right now. So I can get everything.
Okay.
Be by my mom. No.
Okay, you're not looking to get mad.
No.
Okay. You can change your mind though, right?
No.
Okay, good. But I have some advice for you. Just remember to decide how you fit in. Do that. Make yourself happy first. And if you want to give some of that happiness to somebody else, give it to them. But make sure it's what you want to do. And you have to live life on your own terms. Just remember. I know you're going to be successful in whatever you do. So how many years do you think before you'll be a veterinarian? How many years?
From now?
Yes.
Like,
to be a
veterinarian? Like,
yeah,
the
school? Yeah, how many years from now? Gotta finish high school.
Oh, okay.
Gotta go to college.
I say six.
I want to be around that, so I want to bring my dog, I want to bring my dog to you. So the dog will be around family. I want to thank you for what you're doing in this program. I've had a great time being with you, and I know you're going to be wonderful. Okay?
Thank you. Well, that's all with me and Mr. Archie.
LaFon Gilliam, and this is the Intergenerational Oral History Project. Hi, Ms. LaFon. How are you?
Oh, hello there, Simca.
Hi. I just want to start by telling you to tell me a little bit about yourself.
Oh, my gosh. Let's see. I'm a retired Bell South AT&T person. I'm a mother, grandmother. I do a lot of volunteering and traveling since I've retired, and I currently serve on the advisory board for the Absalom Jones Center for Racial Healing.
Okay. Can you tell me about where you're from?
Well, I grew up in a small town in called Oklahoma, in Chickasaw County in northeast Mississippi. I was surrounded by Indian mounds and hills in that part of the state. The town that I grew up in was the site of a Confederate battle, the Battle of Oklahoma, and there are 800 Confederate soldiers buried in the small town of 2000, and there's a big Confederate statue located on Main Street in the roundabout, right down the street from my grandfather's store on Main Street.
Okay. So tell me about your parents.
Well, my both my parents are Mississippians. My dad spent a couple years at Tuskegee College at the time. It wasn't a university. And my mother graduated from Alcorn College. She became a college professor. She taught home economics and psychology and physical science. And my dad was a businessman. He helped in his father's business, my grandfather's business. And he was an entrepreneur. And his last job was he was director of the Mississippi Head Start program when they started Head Start programs. So they were avid community workers. He played golf, and he was a civil rights activist.
Okay. So as a child, what were your goals for the future, just growing up in general?
Well, having grown up on a college campus where my mother taught school, I was surrounded by professionals, faculty members, musicians, artists, biologists, all kinds of teachers. And since my mother was a teacher and my friends' families were teachers, their parents were teachers, we played teacher all the time, like we were having our own classroom. So it was kind of in my blood. I loved a lot of my high school teachers, so I decided I wanted to be a teacher. And I wanted to blend in the business side of my family with the education side of the family. So I majored in business education at Mississippi State University.
Okay, so Ms.
LaFon,
tell me more about your college experience.
Oh gosh, let me just tell you first that coming from a segregated high school, I had some great teachers, but I really was not prepared for mainstream majority universities. And so I went my first year to a small college to kind of get a little under my belt. And then I transferred to Mississippi State University, and that was 5 years after the first black had enrolled. Didn't have access to a lot of alcohol. Mm-hmm. Cut that. Anyway, did well. I was on the dean's list, on the president's list. We started a group, singing group called the Black Voices, and I was in the original Black Voices of that. And that was a big thing. And it's still going on. 40 years later, they're still the Black Voices. He went on to go to medical school and moved to Jackson, Mississippi, and I taught school. And life was good to a point.
My family. We grew up in this neighborhood. It used used to be public housing called John O. Holmes. It's what Castleberry Field is now. And if you ever drive by, you'll see a little community center sitting in the middle of the, right there on Northside Drive. And that was where the community would gather at night, especially on Fridays and Saturday nights. Everyone would be out, moms, dads, children. Dads would be playing checkers, moms would be gossiping probably, and we would just run around. So community and family were very important to me growing up.
What was any like games that you played when you were young before in this paper story?
Hopscotch, we played hopscotch, we did jacks, we boloed, we did the yo-yo. We made up a lot of games. We did Simon Says. I think the most fun I had was once we moved from the projects. Now they call it public housing, then we call it the projects. And we moved to a community called Allensville. And there was a lot of wooded areas, so we would go to the woods and build clubhouses. And that was what was exciting to me as a child, was playing in the clubhouse.
So what did you and your mother do with your son?
Being the youngest, I probably spent more time with my dad than my older sisters did. Daddy was in the home, but he didn't spend a lot of time with us. I got to go places with him probably that my other sisters didn't do. So any time that I had along with him and that he was all mine was good memories. So that was no one specific thing, I guess, other than maybe when we were all as a family sitting around watching television and I got to sit in his lap and watch television. The memory of that I have that still plays an important role in my life is that not only did he do that with me, but he did it with my nieces and my great nieces. So that's what he was known for, us sitting in his lap and watching television.
Are you religious?
Am I?
Religious?
Very. Well, I'm not religious. I'm spiritual. Mm-hmm. I do believe in Jesus Christ, and I know that he is my all in all. I grew up in a household where faith was taught. My mom was very spiritual, so we got a lot of that from her.
Did you have a question? Anything?
As far as religion or spirituality, I questioned a lot about it. It wasn't until I was in my 40s that I really came into the reality of where I stood with my belief in Jesus Christ. I tell people now I'm still growing. I had to have my own personal experiences in order for me to realize that there was someone greater than me that was in control of my life.
Did you have any jobs growing up?
You know, I did at 6 years old, between 5 and 6 years old. I had an uncle, my dad's brother, who was blind, and he also lived in the public housing where we did. And every week it was my job to go and take his trash out. And he would give me 10 pennies every week to go and take his trash out. So I worked at 6, and then I didn't work again until I was 17 and had completed high school. And I worked about 2 weeks at a grocery store, but it was a shady grocery store. So I quit that job and I started working at another grocery store. So my first career was working in the grocery industry, so I worked there for like 30 years.
So did you ever experience racism growing up, like where you worked and stuff, since you were talking about when you were 17?
At 17, no, because that particular store was a black-owned store. But when I got my first real job, it was truly coincidental. My sister was living in some apartments and I went to visit her. And it was on Roswell Road, which is in Buckhead. And I needed a job, so I went into the store and I applied for the job. And miraculously, they hired me. Well, it wasn't until I had been working about a month that I realized that the federal government had filed suit against this company that they were not hiring enough minorities. So they had to hire me because I was black. So the first couple of weeks that I worked, the people would not allow me to ring their groceries up. I could bag their groceries, but they wouldn't let me check them out. So what I did is I decided to just stand in my register all day because I wasn't hired to be a bagger. I was hired as a cashier. So that was my first personal encounter with racism. But as a younger girl growing up, when we would go downtown, there was a store called Rich. Well, all the stores were downtown, Rich's and H&H Green, and I think it was another one called McCrory's. But in Rich's, which is now Macy's, we couldn't shop. We as black people couldn't shop upstairs. We could only shop in the basement. And we could not drink out. I remember even like at 6 and 7, not being able to drink out of the same water fountains. There were still signs on them that said colored and white. And we couldn't use the restroom. We'd have to leave the store and go across the street to the drugstore to use the restrooms. Because I was a little bit younger than my sisters, I did experience through them integration of the high school that they went to. And they would come home and tell my mom about how they, you know, kids would spit on them and parents and stuff threw rocks at their bus and stuff while they were trying to integrate the school. But my first hands-on encounter was when I was 17 or 18, working at the grocery store. And that was one lady in particular. She would always come through my line. And I don't know if she was just testing my honesty or testing me as a black person. But she always paid me too much money. And I would always give it back. I mean, each week she would give me at least $20 too much. Well, after this went on for about a month, I decided not to give the $20 back. Mm-hmm. And she never did it again. So I don't know if she was testing me as a person or testing me as a black person. Mm-hmm. But it ended up for a long time, I was the only black person in that store. But to this day, there are still people that are part of my life that I met during that
to being intergenerational as in terms of just the focus of the work, I think it's really important to bring the young people into the space so that they start having a sense that it belongs to them. I think we create these spaces where healing can occur, but then young people don't feel a sense of ownership. So I hope they have become very comfortable with this space and will want to come back to it for other things as time goes along.